Welcome back to Programming with Qt Widgets. I'm Jesper Pedersen from QTopia. In today's episode, we will look at the dialogs that already do exist in Qt. There's no reason for you to reinvent the wheel and implement, for example, a file dialog. And let's start with the file dialog. It's implemented in the class, no surprise, QFileDialog. QFileDialog has a number of static methods that you'll be using 98.37% of the time. And it goes like this. Get open file name, for example. QFileDialog :: get open file name. It's a static method, as I said, so you'll have to write it out like this. This being the parent pointer. We discussed that in the previous episode. That's where focus will go back to once we are done here. This is the string here, open file. That's the title of the file dialog. It could be get me all your favorite. Well, it's get open file name. So it'll be get me your favorite shot from your holiday. If we wanted multiple files, then we'd need to go to the get open file name. That one allows you to select multiple files. What is returned is the file name or a list of file names. And what you need to realize with the file name here is that this API predates any modern C++. So it's not like it's returning a std optional. Instead, it'll return you a file name. And the file name, you can go and ask it, are you empty or even are you null? The difference between empty and null, we'll discuss that in a later episode. We also have get save file name, and that one is for when you need to save something. It allows you, in contrast to the get open file name, it allows you to specify a file that doesn't exist already, which is what you want to do most of the time when you want to save. And finally, get existing directory for getting, well, a directory. All of these methods take a number of parameters. So go and look up the API. And one of the things that they take is a file pattern where you can specify, I only want to see JPEG and PNG files or whatever, BMP. This is a rather old slide. But anyway. But you can also, if the file is get too cumbersome or if there is a facility in there that is not available via the static method, you can create an instance of a QFileDialog yourself. But be careful. If you create an instance of a QFileDialog, what you will get is an instance of a QFileDialog. No, I did not have a brain damage there. What I'm pointing out is that when you're using one of the static methods, you might not get an instance of a QFileDialog. You might get the system file open dialog that Windows or Mac OS is providing, and that will feel more well integrated into the whole system rather than the instance from QFileDialog. So if you can, by all means, do use the static methods. Can I get some over here? Okay, thank you. Oh, that's good. One of the things we did in QTopia was to help Uno develop their software for their electric scooters. Follow the link for issue queries. Another dialog that exists in the Qt toolbox is the QMessageBox. And QMessageBox, just like QFileDialog, has a number of virtual methods that you'll be using most of the time. There is the first one up here called question, where you can ask it a text here. And then there is a fourth parameter, which buttons should be available. By default, OK and cancel, but you could also have, there's a number of different buttons. I can't remember what they are. You can look that up. And then you will test for the return value of the message box, which was it OK that was selected. It's not like you can ask a string. Well, not like you can ask for type your name. We have another dialog for that, but it's just a give me your answer, choose between a number of different buttons. You can also use one of these three here, information, warning, and critical, and they will just bring up a dialog with an OK button in. Just for your information, it is New Year's Day today. That's an information or critical. I tried to reformat your hard disk, but something went wrong. Yeah, that sucks. That's a critical. The difference between information, warning, and critical is just the icon used. We have about, which is your regular about box where users can go to figure out which version of the software they are really using. Or there's about Qt if you want to do a bit of advertisement for Qt. Or if you want to make sure that you can tell which version of Qt was actually picked up, because it will show you the Qt version number in the about Qt. One facility that I got really used to in the early days of my Qt software development was a do not ask again checkbox, which comes with the KDE version of QMessageBox, but which QMessageBox itself unfortunately do not have. But the good news is that in Qt Widgets and More, I've made a small episode that shows how you can do that. Because QMessageBox more often is used for actually creating an instance of QMessageBox rather than just using the static methods, and that would be for that, or it would be for the use case where you actually want one of the labels on the buttons not to be just the set of 15 different pre-cooked button labels. The next pre-existing dialog in Qt is QProgressDialog. It's a QDialog with a progress bar in it and a cancel button, and that's about it. You can create it like the slide does up here. It's kind of the Qt3 way. We already discussed that in a previous episode where instead of giving all these, what I would rather have seen is that I'll just create a QProgress dialog, set title, set abort button, which this is about, set range, 0, comma, count, and then this was given to the constructor. So 0, comma, count, please do write in a message below if you can come up with an idea where I'm not going from 0 to count steps, but from 10 to 20, I can't see when you would not just use 0. And then I do my actual stuff in here, copying one file, as it says here, for the copy, or calculating whatever I need to calculate. And in each step around, I update how far I made it by calling set value. And one thing that you need to understand with set value is that it will actually run the event loop one time. It will call process events, because if we did not call process event either ourselves or by calling set value, which runs process event, then we would never get the user interface to update, because that's an event coming from Qt itself. Qt will send an update, and the update will then refresh the user interface, but only in the event loop. It is slightly dangerous, because if you had some way of restarting the progress dialog from, say, a push button that was clicked, then that would be possible here. Of course, the QProgress dialog by default is a mobile dialog, so it's not like it is by default easy to get into that trap, but just be aware that the event loop runs around in the set value at least one time. Okay. At least one time. What bollocks is that? It will run around. It will call process event, which simulate it running around one time, and the process event will actually take the whole event queue and process all of those. There we are. That's one catch that I still have bruises after meeting the first time, namely that you need to call set value 0, or I guess set value your min size, because QProgressDialog is smart in the way that it will not show up if it realizes that your calculation is really fast. So you avoid this user interface where you created it on a slow computer, your customer is on a super fast computer, and when they run your application, the dialog comes up and goes away after half a second, another one comes up, it goes away after another half second, and so on. What QProgressDialog will do is that it will calculate how long are you going to take. And of course, Qt still do not have a crystal ball, so it will just do an estimation based on how many steps have you taken, how long has those steps taken, how many steps do you claim there's going to be in total. And the estimation there is based on how long since we started, and that's where the set value 0 comes in. If you do not do that, the dialog will show up right away. You can listen to whether the user has pressed the cancel button in two different ways. You can either, as it says up here, just go and ask for was it canceled, or you can listen to a cancel signal, which you do depend on what is the most, what is the easiest in your setup, really. And that's it for QProgressDialog. We have a few more pre-cooked dialog in Qt that is so trivial that I won't even go into much detail with them. The first one is QInputDialog. That is the dialog that you'll be using when you want to ask the user for his name, or you want him to specify a number, a tuple, or select an item from a list. And that's what we have the static method for: getText, getInt, getTuple, and getItem. That's all there is to QInputDialog. Then we have QColorDialog for asking the user to specify a color, getColor. You can also create an instance of QColorDialog to specify some additional parameters that might not be available through the static method. And similar, we have QFontDialog, and the most easy way to use that is just getFont, or you can create an instance and specify some additional parameters. There is this standard dialog, so go and look at that example. It is what we see over here in screenshot. That's a pretty simple example that shows you the full power of these two different dialogs. Instead of showing you some slides about the last dialog that comes with Qt, let me show you an example instead. It's from the Qt example repository that you get when you install Qt. Go to Qt Creator, welcome up here, examples, and then over here, let me search for it. I want to show you the class QWizard, so I'll just type in this, and you can see there's three examples of that. And this one here is the most complex one, so let's have a look at that. The WizArd is, you see a number of pages in here, and depending on how you get through those pages, it might, as in this example at least, show you a different path. So depending on whether you register your copy or evaluate the product for 30 days, you would either take this path around or you'll take this path around. And depending on what you typed up here, it will either go this way or it'll go straight to the end page of your wizard. Let's see the source code. So it all starts out here in wizard, this license. I would call it wizard wizard, but no, license wizard. Let's go and look at what that class looked like. It has an enum here, representing the different pages. We'll see that in action shortly. It has a constructor, and in the constructor, I create all the pages. And what you'll notice is that I do not set up the direction between those pages because that depends on the input on the pages. I just create the pages with the enum here, and I set the start ID. So we'll start out with this page here. And let's have a look at what a page looks like. A page is subclassing, here we are, from QWizard page. It has a next ID override, which is the one that decides where I'll go. You can see up here is setting up just a regular wizard page. And down here, if the evaluate radio button has been checked, then I should go to evaluate next. Otherwise, I should go to register next. And that's how I get the flow through these pages. At some point, I might also want to have information from an earlier page. And instead of setting up all the pages and giving them pointers to each other, what I will do is simply to specify, see if I can find it somewhere here. I should just search for it. There we are, register field. So in here, I have a checkbox that I would want to be available in another page. Of course, this is a conclusion page, so bad example. Up here, the detail page, the company is details.company. So that's the how I would get to it later on. And I give it the pointer to the QWidget here. So register field, this QWidget, and the asterisk here at the end tells the QWizard page that this field is actually a mandatory one. So the next button will not be available until I've typed something in there. I could, of course, have additional requirements like a QValidator, which we'll see somewhere else in here for the emails field in there. The register field, once I've registered, unfortunately, this example doesn't show. It could easily have done so, but it doesn't. But the way that I would get to those fields is simply calling fields with this name here, and then I'll get a pointer to that other page. And why do I not just have a pointer to the other page? Well, because the flow might not pass through that one, or the flow might pass through two different pages which both have a line edit for, well, the name, for example. Another facility that we can see down here in the conclusion page is that depending on if I have visited this page. So did the flow go through the evaluation, then it'll show this text. If the flow go through the whatever, then I'll show this. Otherwise, I'll show this. And that's how I hook up my pages in the QWizard. There's not much more to it than that. Pretty useful stuff, I admit. I don't think I've created many wizards in my life. It's one of those things that your application might have one or two wizards. But now you know that you have this pretty powerful mechanism, and next time you need a wizard, go and read the details in this example and in the documentation. That's it for this relatively short episode, but man, did I save you a lot of time avoiding implementing a QColor selector. That is not a super trivial dialog to implement, at least. So worthwhile your time, because I'm sure that in your application, you'll need to select colors. And that's it. Next episode, we'll talk about the class QMainWindow. But until then, have a great time.